Good morning, and I want to welcome you to the College Church, and those who are with us online, welcome. And it is a holiday weekend, and I know a lot of people are traveling this weekend, but nonetheless, it is so good to be here, and I know the Lord's going to bless us in a very, very special way today. There's a lot of announcements, so I just want to encourage you. I'm just going to go real fast here today at 4. Well, today is fellowship dinner. And I just spoke with Siv, there's a lot of food, so plan to stay. On that note, the plan is to resume church picnics at people's homes. They're like 5 days, and if you're willing to host a picnic, let Ricardo or Siv Mukuti know about that you're willing to do this. So that's very important. So that's the goal, have 5 this summer. So today is a walk at 4 o'clock. Next Friday night, Young Adult Supper Vespers at the Stevenson's home. And next Sabbath is graduate recognition. And this is the last call for us to get a list of names of those who are graduating this spring so that we can acknowledge them next week. So please make sure that happens. I wanted to mention that today we are going to resume Lamb's Offering. And I did a little calculation. We haven't done Lamb's Offering for about 2 years. I figured it out. It's 104 Sabbaths. So if everybody gave a dollar for those past 104 Sabbaths, we should all be putting in about $104 today, right? I don't think so, but it would be nice. But if we did, it would be pretty good. But if this goes towards our children's ministry, so keep that in mind. We're going to talk about that a little bit later on. But we have some announcements. I'm going to start with Kari, and then Jill, and then Nicole. And as Kari's coming up, I want to just remind the men who are here, we aren't meeting on Monday evening. We are meeting the following Monday, and we are going to start a new curriculum called Stepping Up, a call to courageous manhood. It's going to be very good, and all guys are invited, and if you cannot make it in person, we can definitely get you a Zoom link. So that's going to be a week from Monday evening at 7:30.
Good morning, church. So we're kicking off our Glow Mom adventure that's going to be in August 14, which is a big shower for underserved people, and we're hoping to have a good response. But we need volunteers, so if you are interested at all, we would really appreciate letting us know. We're having our first Zoom meeting on Tuesday at 7 p.m. And I believe Ed has put the Zoom link in the bulletin in the College Church website at this point in time. If not, we'll put it out there as well and let people know. But so it's exciting. We've got a lot of things to plan to get this going. So please, if you're interested, if you have things, ideas, and things that you could help with, we would appreciate you letting us know that you would be on the Zoom meeting for Tuesday. Thank you.
Good morning, church. I just wanted to tweak anyone that's interested in helping. I was planning on doing this just for Creator Role Sabbath School, since that's what I do on Sabbath mornings. But I think we're all in the same boat for Children's Sabbath School, so we can always use more volunteers. So if anybody feels so inclined, contact the church office. You can contact myself. Any of the children's leaders downstairs would appreciate the extra help. It doesn't have to be a regular thing. It could be every 4 weeks, every 6 weeks. Whatever the help we can get would be appreciated. So thank you.
So I've been asked to kind of review what we did last weekend as a Pathfinder group. So last week we went on our spring camporee at the camp meeting grounds in Lancaster. It had been a few years since we'd been able to do in person. And so I have a few slides from last weekend. There was about 6 of us who went. Due to COVID, we would have had more, but they had a little bit of restrictions. The kids had a really fun time. So the conference had a photographer, and they took a picture of each club, and they presented us with plaques. So we have one for College Church, which was really nice. They put the name of the campery, which is, "Now is the time to fulfill our purpose." And we got third place overall. So there was a lot of clubs that you would earn points for different activities that you were part of. Sophia and Kate, it was nice, they went up on stage. They had a call for baptism, and so two of our members want to be baptized, so that was nice. It was very hot, so we did survive the heat. We even did a 5K on Sunday morning. So thank you guys for supporting our Pathfinder Club. Next year, we hope to have more at the campery. Thank you.
All right.
All right, we got something big happening. Yay! What would that be, Nicole?
Good morning, everyone. So we're back to talk about Vacation Bible School. Who's excited?
Woo! All right.
It's gonna be really amazing. Yeah. So do you want me to
say what's
jump
going
in?
On?
Okay. Yep. So as you know, or anyone who wasn't here last week, we're doing Vacation Bible School June 27th to July 1st. Lots of little cuties like this one here we're hoping will attend. And we have a really exciting week planned for the kids. The theme this year is Jasper Canyon. I actually have a surprise for you.
What the?
I didn't tell anyone this, but AUC reached out to me. And they actually will be donating their rock and fossil collection for Vacation Bible School. So we'll have some fossils and rocks for the kids to look at, which is really amazing. We're gonna have a rock wall. So it's gonna be really fun. Just please pre-register your kids so that we can get an accurate count. We wanna try to get t-shirts for all the children and some cool little Jasper Canyon swag bags. So we wanna make sure we have enough of those things. And this is also something that we want to reach out to the entire community. It's not just for our church family, although we love you all dearly, but we are asking each child to bring a friend, right? So sign up for yourself and then invite someone at your school or your neighbor or somebody, anybody, and just say, hey, we have this really amazing week planned. We have a parents' lounge, so parents can come as well and just hang out, enjoy a nice refreshing lemonade or something like that, and talk while their kids are playing, learning about God. It's 4 p.m. to 7 p.m. every night. I think that's all I have.
So it does include, was there a light supper?
It's a light supper, yep, from 4 p.m. to 5 p.m. And that's just, you know, so it's no pressure. You get off work, pick up your kid, come, we'll feed you all, and we can go into the evenings activities.
And the weather will be perfect
that
week.
It's going to be perfect. I put my request in.
That's it. Me too. So keep praying.
Yeah.
But yeah, that sounds good. And you will, we're going to have a visual impact out here on Main Street so that people will see what's happening. And I will challenge us to invite our neighbors. Mm. And you may have grandchildren. Encourage them to come. And it's going to be a really, really wonderful time. So, and when you look at the scope of the last 2 years, essentially, this is our first significant outreach of the community.
Yep.
So this is it, and we don't know what's going to happen in the fall and the winter, but let's, you know, start this off on the right foot. So.
Absolutely. We were actually talking in deep calling this morning about how we can connect more. This is an opportunity. We all know a family with children, with small children. Go out and connect. Invite them to something that is completely non-threatening. I mean, it's food, a rock wall, fun.
What can go wrong? Well, we shouldn't put like that.
Yeah, but it's gonna be a lot of fun. And everything that, if there's one thing that every single person sitting here right now can do is to please put this effort into prayer.
Yeah.
Please pray for it every day, that the children will be blessed, that everyone that's involved in the planning, because we're just representing a small fraction of the people that are involved in planning this, that we are doing it to God's honor and glory, Amen. And that it will truly be a blessing for our church and for our community. So thank you in advance for those prayers. Go onto the church website, and there's a Vacation Bible School section. Just click on that, and you'll see everything about registering. But you can also just, you know, grab me if you need help navigating to that, and I'm more than happy to help you.
Thank you. Oh, Faith.
Yes, yes. That's a great question. Thank you, Faith. Yes, anybody who would like to volunteer, I'm going to say, oh, and we're going to be sending out a direct mailing to about 2,600 homes in Lancaster. So we're praying that that will be a huge turnout, in which case we absolutely need volunteers to make sure that we're able to keep the children safe and to make it as fun and smooth as possible whenever you're inviting, you know, 200 kids to come gather on a lawn.
We never know.
Yeah. So please, if volunteer doesn't mean you have to have direct contact with the children. We need help with setup. We need help with tear down, you know, registration. So there's a little bit of something for everyone. You don't necessarily have to be involved and in the mix with, you know, the big group activities. There's a lot to do leading up to VBS and then the week of. So if you feel so impressed to help out, just grab me and we can talk about different ways that we can get you involved.
All right, great.
Thank you.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. Please bow your heads with me for prayer. Dear Jesus, thank you for this day. Please help us to have a wonderful day today, and please help us to gain a blessing from the service today. In Jesus' name, amen. The call to worship today is found in Psalms 92, 1-5, and I will be reading from the NIV version. It is good to praise the Lord and make music to your name, O Most High, proclaiming your love in the morning and your faithfulness at night, to the music of the 10-string lyre and the melody of the harp. For you make me glad by your deeds, Lord. I sing for joy at what your hands have done. How great are your works, Lord, and how profound are your thoughts. Thank you.
Morning has broken. Number 44.
Practice will be good. I'm hoping the slideshow works, but if it doesn't, there we go. There's our first picture. Raise your hand if you know what an avalanche is. Okay, I see a hand here. And do you know that avalanches are dangerous? That's a picture of an avalanche in a ravine. Now, that one happens to have been taken in the Himalayas. Sometimes when there's a lot of snow on mountains, it will slide down the mountain very fast, especially if the mountain is steep. In that picture, the mountain is steep. There's a lot of snow, and it's sliding very fast. The National Geographic says that an avalanche can weigh more than 1 million tons and travel as fast as 200 miles per hour. Very fast. They're not all that fast, but some of them are very fast. Avalanches can break trees, smash houses, and sometimes they kill people. There, an avalanche is dangerous. When I was 15 years old, I got to spend a couple of weeks at a ski area, next slide please, in Austria called Hochsulden. Hoch means high, Sulden. At the base of this mountain is a town called Sulden, and this is High Sulden. There were many switchback turns to drive up to that. Very pretty place. Got to stay up there for 2 weeks. One day, my parents decided to take the gondola. It's a kind of a big ski lift. Next slide, please. To a different part of the mountain, much higher. That is the picture of the gondola station on the right. That's where the gondola goes in and out of. And as you can see, there's a little bit of snow, and it's fairly steep. And to get to the gondola meant to go down the mountain from where we were, and then they would take a bus to the gondola station and then ride the gondola to the top of this mountain. I had an idea. I was always having ideas, and mostly they got me into trouble. Instead of taking the bus, no, going down and taking the bus, I mean, who wants to ride a bus? I thought it would be fun to try to ski to the gondola. There were no ski trails going to the gondola, none at all. So this meant that I would need to do what's called backcountry skiing. And when you do backcountry skiing, one of the dangers is avalanches. I wasn't scared. I'm going to do it. So I slipped under the rope that marks the boundary where the safe skiing is, and I started my backcountry skiing, what we call out of bounds, meaning it's outside of the proper area where you're supposed to stay within. And for a while, it went just fine. It went well. But then I came to a ravine. Remember the picture we had earlier of a ravine? Steep area, and it was full of snow, really steep, and it went way up the mountain. How am I going to cross that ravine? If I hike all the way up around, it's going to take me at least 2 hours. And my parents will be worried. So I decided I would jump off the ravine, jump into the ravine, and get up a lot of speed and go up the other side as far as I could, finish hiking up the other side and keep going. And I jumped off the ravine, and as soon as I landed in the snow in the ravine, I heard a whoop. And I looked and I realized I had just triggered an avalanche. And the avalanche was starting all the way up in the ravine, and the snow was coming down. I can't go back. Gravity doesn't work that way. I have jumped into the ravine. What was I going to do? Well, I did the only thing I could think of to do. I decided to try to surf that avalanche, like, you know, when you watch a surfer on the ocean riding a wave. I decided to surf the wave of the avalanche. What else could I do? And that's what I did. I surfed that avalanche, and the snow was flying over me. You know, you saw the picture earlier, and all, yeah, it's wild time. And I kept up my momentum, and I skied up the other side, and I skied out of the avalanche. The avalanche went right on past me out the other side, so it was really fortunate. Probably not the most dangerous thing I ever did by quite a bit, but that was one. So now I have a question for you. Did God save me? Or was I lucky? Well, the Bible says in Ecclesiastes that time and chance happen to all. Luck, according to the Bible, happens to us all. And we also know from the Bible that everybody who is in a dangerous situation, even if they love God, and I was struggling with that at that time, I didn't know God very well, they're not always saved. Remember the story from the Bible of Stephen, the martyr? He wasn't saved. The disciples mostly ended up dying. Many people were killed that were martyrs. So God does not always save us in dangerous situations. Now, here's an idea for you to think about and talk about with your moms and dad. Even though God does not always save us, God always loves us. Always loves us. And here's the funny part. Love cannot exist without luck. That's the idea I want you to think about. Because if God always saved us because we loved God, then it would be like what Lucifer said to God at the beginning of the book of Job. Well, yeah, Job loves you because you always save him. If you don't always save him, he'll stop loving you. Did Job stop loving God? No, he didn't. Though he slay me, Job said, yet will I trust in him. God always loves us, even if he doesn't always save us here and now. The Bible says all things work together for good for those that love the Lord. But that good may not always be as we want it to happen right here and right now. All right, shall we pray? Head back to our seats. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, thank you for always loving us, always doing what's right for us, even when it's not what we want to happen. We love you too. Amen.
That time for us to spend a little bit of time talking to God. So as far as you guys are able, let's kneel and pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, I thank you for the opportunity to worship you and know you more in this beautiful building, on this beautiful Sabbath with these beautiful fellow sinners. I wish I could say I had not a care in the world, but you know all too well that to be a lie. I'm a broken man with a heavy heart. We are a broken people, and we live in a broken nation. As I talked to my boys last night, thoroughly amazed at how they had grown into capable and thoroughly awesome young men with burgeoning dreams and aspirations, I confess that it angered me to think that there are 19 more families in this country that are not dreaming of a future for their children. They instead must be in a state of anguish as they prepare to lay their children to rest in the ground way too soon, way too soon. I confess that it angers me that instead of coming together as a nation to address this lethal and evil obsession with the protection of a piece of metal over the protection of our very own citizens, we instead choose to further dig into our respective sides of the aisle and throw rocks at each other, one tweet or TikTok at a time. And I confess that it angers me that we have allowed Satan to weaponize this anger into a cement around our hearts and minds. But I know your love. I know that this anger, where this anger is coming from, and I know that anger is not going to solve this problem. Please, Lord, I beg that you soften my heart and my mind. I beg that you open our eyes. And that as we take every breath in the days ahead, that those beautiful verses in Matthew 22 embed themselves like an earworm into our hearts. We need to put aside all that anger and replace it with love. We need to bring back empathy as a driver for how we interact with those around us. And we need to love our neighbors as we love ourselves, unconditionally. We need to grieve as a nation, and then we need to, with love in our hearts, begin to act again like the nation we are capable of. Lord, I mourn for the residents and families of Uvalde that are just the latest in an all too long line of grieving communities struggling with this senseless act of evil. Please fill us with love. Help us to be a living and breathing personification of your love in our words, and more importantly, our actions, and help us to use our remaining time on this earth in a much better way than we have been. Teacher, which commandment in the law is the greatest? He said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment. And a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." Amen.
from the fear of serving others, from the fear of death or trial, from the fear of humility. Deliver me, O God.
Today's scripture reading is found on page 228 of your pew Bibles, 1 Samuel 17, 45 through 47. But David said to the Philistine, "You come to me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This very day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you down and cut off your head. And I will give the dead bodies of the Philistine army this very day to the birds of the air, to the wild beasts of the earth, so the earth may know there is a God in Israel, and that all assembled may know that the Lord does not save by sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hand."
Thank you for that powerful message and music. That was very, very touching. And Ralph, your children's story was deep. It's a thinker. It really is. And it was good. I appreciate that. And Bianca, good to have you back. And thank you. So let's bow our heads for prayer. Father in heaven, Lord, it is good that we've come to the house of the Lord on the day of the Lord. And we pray that you'll continue to be here as we look at this very, very familiar story. Lord, perhaps this story is here for us to learn from at this point in time. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Do we have any Andy Griffith Show fans out here? Yes, all right, there we go. And the star of the show, or one of the stars, is of course Ron Howard. Ron Howard. And you know, just in case Ron Howard is watching, I want to thank you for not joining the Hair Club for Men, all right? Thank you. And if you've seen recent pictures of him, he has changed considerably from the Andy Griffith time. Well, I share this with you because I'm going through his semi-autobiography he co-authored with his brother Clint. And my wife was listening to the book on CD, and I said, "That sounds interesting." And I got the book, and fascinating about seeing life sort of behind the scenes, behind the camera. And he gets very personal, And schooling for him was rather interesting because he found himself part of the time he's in what they call studio school and part of the time he was in a public school. And he was in kindergarten in public school, then he was in studio school, and then he's going back to public school in the second grade. The problem was, it's second grade. The other problem was the school year had already started. And so he gets into school, and he's just, by the way, starting the Andy Griffith Show. And so people are noticing, that's Opie, that's Opie. And they're recognizing him from TV. They see him at nighttime, and there he is in their classroom. Well, Ron says that he appreciated the life that he had in acting. He really enjoyed it. But now he's in this other arena. And the one thing he does not want to do is to be singled out and, of course, be picked on. He doesn't want that to happen. So the school year is already in session. He comes, shows up, it's unseen. And you know that's very awkward, to come in mid-school year. So he comes in, and he said, my first week of school, I didn't feel safe going to the bathroom because there were the big guys there. The big guys. And one day he had to go, and of course he goes, and what happens? There's the big guys, and they hassle him in the bathroom. So Ron tells in his book, he comes to a solution. He will just hold all day long. He's going to hold because he doesn't want to deal with the boys in the bathroom. So the day comes. He's going to hold. Morning's fine. He gets through lunchtime, and he's watching the clock. 2:45. 2:45, the day is over, and he knows those guys, they're not going to spend a minute in school longer than they have to, so it'll be safe to go to the bathroom. You probably know where the story's going. A few minutes before 2:45, just couldn't hold it. And he said he was totally embarrassed and humiliated. Some of the kids laughed at him. He ran home, told his parents what had happened. They assured him that it's just because of the novelty, you're the new kid, let it wear off and go through the school year. And his parents were very, very supportive. Go through the school year, see how it goes, and if you don't like it by the end of the school year, we'll transfer you to the studio school or to school where acting kids go. By the end of the year, the parent says, so Ron, do you want to transfer or do you want to stay? You know what he said? He wants to stay. He wants to stay. By next year, he says, he had his own posse of kids. Now, I'm saying that because that story is something we could probably all relate to in a way. That having to deal with a bully or a problem or an obstacle, and we go way out of our way to deal with it, but in fact, it really doesn't actually solve many problems. Facing our fears, facing problems, facing bullies is a part of life. Just ask Jesus. Just ask David. With that, turn with me in your Bibles to that 3,000-year-old favorite story of ours. When that day when Goliath meets the God of David. Now, this, incidentally, is the final chapter of Goliath's life. We know the story. It's the final chapter of his life. But it's a brand new chapter for David's life. David finds himself in he's less than 20 years of age. He's probably 18, 19 years of age. So our young adults, please pay attention. Because this was a moment, a defining moment. And it's a time, as far as geographically goes, it's between Bethlehem and the Mediterranean Sea. So it's about 15 miles from Bethlehem to go to where this battle is. Saul is king, but they find themselves at a stalemate because there's a problem named Goliath. So with that, let's pick it up in verse 2 of 1 Samuel chapter 17. It says here, Saul and the Israelites assembled and camped in the valley of Elah and drew up their battle line to meet the Philistines. The Philistines occupied one hill and the Israelites another, with the valley between them. A champion named Goliath, who was from Gath, came out of the Philistine camp. His height was 6 cubits and a span. He had bronze helmet on his head and wore a coat of scale armor of bronze weighing 5,000 shekels. On his legs he wore bronze greaves, and a bronze javelin was hung on his back. His spear shaft was like a weaver's rod, and its iron point weighed 600 shekels. His shield bearer went ahead of him. Malcolm Gladwell, in a book by the title David and Goliath, asked a very important and simple and profound question. When we see the giant, why do we automatically assume the battle is his for the winning? It's a good question. When we see the giant, why do we automatically assume that the battle is his for the winning? And he goes on to say the problem is what we consider as an advantage and what we consider as a disadvantage. When in fact, what we see as an advantage may really be a disadvantage. And what may be a disadvantage actually, in fact, is an advantage. We have our thinking backwards. So there's been a lot of speculation about what caused Goliath to be so big. He is 9'9". 9'9". So if anybody's 6 feet tall, put a yardstick over that person's head and add 9 more inches. He's huge. So a speculation is that he had a disease called acromegaly. Acromegaly. It is a tumor that impedes the pituitary gland by or impacts the pituitary gland by producing more of the growth hormone. So Goliath just kept growing and growing and growing and wasn't stopping. The interesting part about this disease is the side effects. One of the side effects is vision problems. He probably, if this is the case, he probably couldn't see very well. And this is perhaps one of the reasons why the armor bearer goes ahead of him. He's sort of serving as a guide to him. And it's interesting that when he's going to finally fight David, he tells David, come to me and I will feed your flesh to the birds. Well, why does he have to come? Why doesn't Goliath be the aggressor? Why doesn't he move forward to him? So it makes you wonder, did Goliath have this disease? Did he have this? And did he really, was he able to see? Because that's what I see as part of the issue when we face our problems. When we face our Goliaths, it's all about how we see them. How we really, really see them. And are we willing to deal with them? So with that, let's jump to verse 10 of 1 Samuel 17. It says here, then the Philistine said, this day I defy the armies of Israel, give me a man. And let us fight each other. On hearing the Philistines' words, Saul and all the Israelites were dismayed and were terrified. And verse 16, for 40 days, the Philistine came forward every morning and every evening and took his stand. 40 days. Haddon Robinson has an interesting formula he's developed. It's a very simple formula. It's simple as this. Pain plus time plus insight equals change. Pain plus time plus insight equals change. Now, that's an amazing observation because 1 Samuel 17 has all three of those components. The pain is a name called Goliath, the Philistines. And the time is for 40 days, Goliath keeps coming out and egging him on, fight me, fight me, fight me. And actually, it's not 40, just 40 days, it's 80 times. Because coming out in the morning and the evening, and he says, come out, is your God who you see as strong as you think he is? Well, let's fight. But the problem is, there's no insight yet. The insight hasn't arrived yet because the insight is actually, shall we say, is driving Uber Eats car right now. He is. Because if you pick it up in verse 17, now Jesse said to his son David, take this ephah of roasted grain and the 10 loaves of bread for your brother and hurry to their camp.
Take along these 10 cheeses to the commander of their unit. See how your brothers are doing and bring back some assurance from them. They are with Saul, and the men of Israel are in the Valley of Elah fighting against the Philistines. David's day begins driving Uber Eats, killing a giant, and will be end up in the inner circle of the king in one day. My friends, it is amazing what can happen a day, isn't it? Isn't it amazing? And what's amazing is how his day begins, because obviously he starts early. When you do the math about the grain, which is about 35 to 36 pounds, 10 loaves of bread, 10 cheeses, I'm thinking the pack is about 55 pounds. Now, if you've ever done any backpacking, that's a decent pack. That's pretty heavy. And he's going to walk 15 miles with that pack in that morning. So he arrives, and I would think he might be a little tired. But he gets to the scene, and he sees what's going on, and he wants to see his brothers, see how they are doing, which is where things begin to change. Because in verse 23, as he was talking with them, the brothers, Goliath, the Philistine champion, came from Gath, stepped out from his lines, and shouted his usual defiance, and David heard it. Whenever the Israelites saw the man, they all fled from him in fear. What are you afraid of? What are we afraid of? Well, the survey was done last year. Top 10 fears, America's top fears. Here they are. Loved ones dying. This is in the heart of the pandemic. Loved ones dying. Loved ones becoming seriously ill. Mass shootings. Not having enough money for retirement. Terrorism. Government corruption. Becoming terminally ill. And hate crimes. All things that we are still grappling with to this very moment. What are we afraid of? What was David afraid of? What was David afraid of? And it says in verse 26, David asked the men standing near him, "What will be done for the man who kills this Philistine and removes this disgrace from Israel? Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God?" You know what David was concerned about? David was concerned about the heart of God. David was concerned about the heart of God. You see, David's only here because of one moment, one criteria. He was anointed by Samuel, and because a simple fact is that David was at the bottom of the totem pole. He is the youngest kid. And the key criteria was that people look at the outward appearance, but what? God look at that, the what? At the heart. David realizes that. And I believe that David is looking at the heart of God. How does this impact God? How does he see this? And what must this make him feel? And so he's upset. And he doesn't ask the question, why doesn't God get rid of this giant? He doesn't ask that. He doesn't say, why doesn't God just do a miracle and kill Goliath in his sleep? He doesn't do that. And I think sometimes we have to say, okay, God, maybe God wants us to have an A in that class, but he won't mysteriously give it to us, will he? We have to work at it. If you want a raise, you have to earn it or ask for it. If you say, give me a spouse, he may or may not do that, but largely he's going to say, go find one. If you want a better job, you're going to have to find it. And if you want to get to the top of the mountain, you have to climb it. And David did something interesting that morning. He took about 33,000 steps to go from Bethlehem to the battlefront. He's been fighting lions, he's been fighting bears, and he's come to this point in his life. And my friends, sometimes, as it's been said, that God says if you have faith, you can move a mountain, but sometimes what he'll do is he'll give us a shovel. He will give us a shovel. And so David is there, comprehending the situation. And it says there in verse 28, when Eliab, now that's the oldest son, David's oldest brother, heard him speaking with the men, he burned with anger at him and asked, "Why have you come down here? And with whom did you leave those few sheep in the wilderness? I know how conceited you are and how wicked your heart is. You came down only to watch the battle." Eleanor Roosevelt once said, "No one can make you feel inferior without your consent." I think that's true. I think it's true. And it's interesting because so many times we listen to what other people tell us and we let that shape us. There's an old Indian legend of a man who was going through the woods and he found an eagle's egg. And he took that egg and he put it into the nest of a prairie chicken. You may have heard this before. Well, the eagle hatched, started growing up, and was in there with the other with the chickens. And that eagle began to actually behave just like a chicken. He just started behaving like a chicken. And then one day this eagle is growing and he's looking up in the sky and he sees this magnificent bird flying in the sky. It's amazing, it's majestic, and it's just floating there in the currents. And it's amazing, it's dazzling. And this little eagle looks up and says, "What is that?" He asks his fellow chickens, he asks the chicken, "What is that?" And the answer comes back, "Wow, that's an eagle, the chief of the birds." But the chicken chuckled back to him and says, "But don't give it a second thought. You could never be like him." And the eagle continued to live just like a chicken till he ended up dying. There's sometimes we should not listen to what other people say about us. You know what I'm saying? There are some times we need to filter that out. And David does just that, because in verse 29, you can hear this sibling spat coming out. In verse 29, he looks at Eliab and says, "Now what have I done? Can't I even speak?" Then he turned to someone else and brought up the same matter, and the men answered him before. Whatever David said was overheard and reported to Saul, and Saul sent for him. It's interesting because we might ask ourselves, what is the key moment of this story? What is the real apex of this story? Is it when David goes before Saul, and as the Bible says, he literally is holding Goliath's head? This is barbaric stuff, by the way. He literally goes before the king. He's got Goliath's head in his hand. Is that the apex of the story? Is the apex of the story when David uses Goliath's own sword to decapitate Goliath? Is that it? Or is the apex of the story when that stone mysteriously flies through space and hits Goliath on the perfect spot, leaving him, how should we say it, knocked out? Or is it when David says, "You come at me with a sword and a javelin, but I come at you with the name of the Lord"? That's it. But that part only happens because of what we see right here. Right here. It's in the mundane, in the boring part. Because what David does is he looks at his brother and says, "What have I done now? Can't I even speak?" He turns away from Eliab. Okay? He turns away from Eliab and he looks at somebody else. And he asked the same question: what's going to happen to the guy who gets rid of this Philistine? And the answer comes back, well, he's going to get wealthy, he's going to get a wife, and he's going to get tax-exempt status. Now that seems like motivation. So he's asking people, and word gets back to the king about this guy asking these questions. Now this is really important, Because if David had said to Eliab, you know what, you're right, what am I doing here? I'm just going to go back to Bethlehem. I'm leaving the food. I'm going back home. But do you realize it's interesting? What he does in this moment is so pivotal. This is a turning point in him, in his life. David, from this moment on, will not go back home as what we call, might call David boy. He won't go home after this moment. If you look at 1 Samuel 18, verse 2, he doesn't go back home. Oh, he'll go back to Bethlehem, but not as the son. He's going back as a ruler. He's going back, or even as a fugitive, but he's not going back home. He is turning the page on his new life here. He is no longer the youngest son of Jesse. He is no longer that. He's starting to become someone else in this very moment. Because he's decided to make a significant decision and to face the giants. Not just the giant, but the giants in his life. And verse 31 says, what David said was overheard and reported to Saul, and Saul sent for him. And verse 32 said, David said to Saul, now by the way, so in a few moments, David is ushered into the presence of the king. And David said to Saul, let no one lose heart on account of this Philistine. Your servant will go and fight him. Your servant will go and fight him. But it says here, verse 33, but Saul replied, you're not able to go out and fight this Philistine. You're only a young man. He's been a warrior from his youth. Now, my friends, you and I know the stories. We've heard the list. Beethoven was considered a hopeless composer at one point. Einstein was described by one of his teachers as intellectually slow. Walt Disney was fired from a job because of lack of creativity. You remember these stories? We have the list. And now we see this almost about to happen here. But David pushes back. He says, no, this can be done. Because you know why? David's been doing it his entire life. When a bear threatens a sheep, he takes care of it. When a lion threatens a sheep, he takes care of it. And now he says, you know what? When a Philistine threatens God's sheep, I will take care of it. I will take care of it. Malcolm Gladwell in the book says, courage is not something that you already have that makes you brave when the tough times start. Courage is what you earn when you've been through the tough times and you discover they aren't so tough after all. It's true. Those moments when we need to face that little Goliath and the big Goliath, those moments when we have to deal with them. And I know how it is to be a human being. It's so easy to sweep them under the rug. I do it myself. I do it myself. But there's something amazing that happens when we dare to face that giant. When we dare to face the giant. And Saul eventually comes around in the latter part of verse 37. It says, Saul said to David, go and the Lord be with you. And we know how the story ends. We know it. We know it so well. The question is what do we do in the intermediate part? What do we do in that part there where we have to make these simple decisions day by day by day? Winston Churchill, after World War II, was giving an address at Westminster. He was being introduced by the Prime Minister. And the Prime Minister said that the Battle of the Bulge was won because the British soldiers were braver than the Nazi soldiers, and that was why they won. Churchill gets up to the podium and begins by saying these simple words, with great reluctance, I must challenge my honored colleague. The British soldiers were not braver than the Nazi soldiers. The difference was that the British soldiers were brave 5 minutes longer. May God give us that bravery and that courage that we need to face those giants. Thank you.
his wings. Number 529.
Under his wings, unsafely abiding, through the night deep winds and tempests are wild, still I can trust in my God, he will keep me. He has redeemed me, and I am his child. Under his wings, who from his love can sever? Under his wings, my soul shall abide, safely alive forever. Under his wings, what a refuge in sorrow. How the heart yearningly turns to its rest. Often when earth has no balm for my healing, there I find comfort, and there I am blessed. Under his wings, who from his love can sever? Under his wings, my soul shall abide, safely abide forever. Under his wings, oh, what precious enjoyment, there will I hide till life's trials are o'er. Sheltered, protected, no evil can harm me. Resting in Jesus, I'm safe evermore.
I invite you to pray with me. Father in heaven, I've come to the conclusion that if you're a human being, you will face Goliaths. We're going to face those giants, and I'm sure we could talk all afternoon about the giants we have faced and are facing. Lord, we want to thank you for the past victories. And we pray that you will be with us as we face the current challenges. Lord, they could be a relational problem, a financial problem, a career problem, physical problem. The list goes on. Lord, we just pray that you will give us the right approach, the right timing, and the right energy to face those Goliaths. Lord, we know this story. We love this story. We see that it was so pivotal on that one moment. Who was David going to listen to? Lord, I pray that as we go forth from here, that we will listen to you, to your calling. Where are you calling us to? To the life that you want us to have. Lord, I know for one thing, it is not to live in the shadow of a giant named Goliath, but it is to live underneath your wings. Be with us as we go forth from here. Be with us as we enjoy our fellowship time together. And may we find this Sabbath to be indeed a blessing. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.